Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of the Microgreen Show. Well, with today's episode, we are going to go revisit Garfield Produce and have Shanquelle, the grower, interview me. I thought this would be a good way of answering questions for the audience. Since Shanquelle is an everyday grower, he'd be a perfect person to interview me. So let's go on with that episode. So I thought today we would do an episode for the audience, right? The audience have a lot of questions. I don't really know how to answer the questions for the audience because I don't see them. You being the person that's always working in the grow room, I figured that you would have questions that can help the audience, you know? You can ask me any questions you want. I'll go over the question with you and let's just start getting to some conversation here. Yeah, sunflower, I would say, is the one that I really enjoy growing the most. It's just hardier. Contains a lot of nutrients, not too hard to grow at all. Sunflower would definitely be the one, you know. I made it very challenging for myself. When I started my operation, I immediately went into all these different varieties. I started growing, maybe about 40 different varieties from the beginning when I started. I didn't know, you know, I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know what I was getting into. I just wanted to figure it out. And I think that was I made it super hard for me, because I chose more varieties to learn. To meeting 40 people and expecting to know everybody's characteristics in one day, that would be very hard. So that's kind of where I was at. There's 40 different characteristics of plants that I had to learn in a short period of time, and that made it difficult. Along with the chefs asking for more and me trying to please the chefs, it made it super difficult. So I say not choosing a couple varieties to focus on was probably a bad decision that I made. So when people start off with the growing, I really recommend them to choose a couple varieties, 3-4 varieties, and just be a master at them 3 or 4 varieties. But one of the books that I first bought when I got into this was the ABCs to NFT. ABCs to NFT was the first book that I got. And it was a very expensive book. The book is, I think it's worth about $2,000 online because if it was a special edition when it came out. But Cooper's the first one that started studying NFT in the 70s and 80s, and this is all his research from that. So basically, you're picking up somebody else's research and moving from there. And that's basically what I did. I jumped into it, learning from the professional and also other professionals, and I was encouraged by other professionals to keep heading in the route that I was heading in. And that's why, you know, I'm here right now. Trial and error.
Trial and error.
So trial means I tried something, I messed up, and I made it better. And the way I trialed and error is I had the best Michelin star restaurants I was working with, which they have the best palate. They're not gonna lie to me. They're gonna tell me if it's too strong. They're gonna tell me if it's sweet. They're gonna tell me if it's perfect. Whatever their palate's saying was what I was trying to perfect. I had people give me opinions on my product. And I think accepting opinions on your product is something you want, truthful opinions that people are gonna tell you the truth of, hey, this is not good, and just not trying to be nice to you. So I would say trial and error with chefs is how I developed the recipe. Or even, I found out that nutrients do matter in microgreens through selling them through chefs, if that makes sense. That's how I found out that I used to fertilize my microgreens like regular plants in the beginning, and all the chefs would say it was too strong. The flavoring was way too strong. How can you make it weaker? So I started to do micronutrients. And when I started to play with these micronutrients, I started to notice the flavors and the oil profiles on the plants popping more. And the chefs even noticed that too. You know, so trial and error, working with people that are gonna give you honest opinions. So it's never fighting mold. It's more preventing mode. So what we do is we put together a program that's a preventative for mold, preventative for pathogens, preventative for anything like that. And what we use is bacteria. Okay. So we use a cocktail of bacteria that take care of all of these things. And the way they take care of it is these bacteria are super hungry and they're gonna eat all the food available that leaves no food behind for anything else to survive, pathogens, are even some bad bacteria that's trying to get up in there and take over as well.
Beneficial
bacteria will take over your whole thing. And so it's a program of spraying beneficials, of just using beneficials in different ways, which are microgreen operations. So a combination also keeping everything sterile and clean and like how you have here. You know, this place is absolutely gorgeous. The way you have your clean room. I mean, just this place you can walk into and just know that this place is clean. And that's what I like to see with grow rooms, because that's one aspect of keeping mold and things down. And then the other aspect is preventatives. So you got cleansiness and preventatives that can help you with preventing mold and other things happening. So there's two ways to control humidity, right? One way to control humidity is by a dehumidifier, right? So you have a dehumidifier in the room to control the humidity at right. And you can also have a humidifier. Will also add the humidity because it might be too dry, especially in the winter months, right? So it's a combination of a dehumidifier and humidifier. But if you don't have these things, then you can also dehumidify with heat. So you put the heat on a little bit, get the heat up going. Yeah, the plants are gonna have to, you know, with the heat a little bit, but that will dry the air out a little bit, and then you can work with that as well. So there's little tricks to the trade to be able to control the humidity. Is the humidity low outside? Maybe you wanna open up the door and get that humidity in and get a fan to rush the humidity out of the grow room. That's another way of doing it, you know? So there's many ways of you know, using air conditioning, heating, dehumidifiers, humidifiers to control your humidity in the grow room. And also using the outdoor temperature if the humidity's low, you know? LEDs are direct lighting, so they're just constantly going directly down, okay. Right? And when you have a fluorescent lighting, a fluorescent tube spreads the light out. It goes everywhere and penetrates everywhere. Well, LEDs are not penetrating everywhere, so they're kind of going down, and you can see the unevenness going on because some certain areas are getting more lighting than others. It's not spreading out evenly. If fluorescent light and LED were together, you would see more evenly, and you would see actually the LED work help it a lot because the fluorescent's pushing the LED and spreading the LED out. So a combination of LED and fluorescent would fix that. Yeah. So you need LED and fluorescent lighting. Thank you everybody for joining me for another episode of the Microgreen Show. And thank you Shanquel, and thank you Garfield Produce for having me over again. I really enjoyed being interviewed by a grower because it helps me really get questions answered for the audience. And once again, like always, happy Friday and be safe.